You know, it was much better. Okay, I hope you can see this. Well, title of my talk, Phase Field Approach to Phase Transformation, Dislocation Pileup, and the Interaction at Nano and Microscale. And I would like to acknowledge my co-author student, current PhD student, my collaborators and funding agencies. And of course, no, I don't need because I am recording. And of course, after first two talks, my introduction part can be shortened significantly. So key point is we have at the moment nanoscale phased field approach for modeling of interaction between phase transition and plasticity. And our goal is to scale it up. And actually, it's not just to consider millimeter, centimeter size, maybe it's kilometer because for geophysical problems. So actually, we want to make scale-free approach. And our main application will be plastic strain-induced phase transformations under high pressure and plastic shear in rotational diamond angles. Well, I believe I can skip now this slide, because key point again, this is scale, and you see multiple twins within 3 nanometers, and interface is probably nanometer, dislocation core is the same, so we cannot treat large sample. And one of the most popular approach is to artificially increase interface width. So, for example, by 3 orders of magnitude. Well, maybe it works for some purposes. For our goal, it does not work because we will study high pressure phase transformations and they have huge hysteresis, pressure hysteresis, stress hysteresis, temperature hysteresis. And what does it mean? So this is stress strain curve. This is direct phase transition and initiation of reverse phase transition. Difference is hysteresis. For example, graphite to diamond, direct phase transition occurs at 70 GPa, reverse phase transition does not occur at all. So it's huge hysteresis. And key problem is nucleation, not growth, but nucleation. And we want to keep it. Now, if we increase width of interface, these are simple equations, yeah, and by keeping energy. So this is a parameter characterizing double well potential. And if you keep energy, this height of parameter is in inverse proportion to interface width. And both temperature hysteresis and stress hysteresis, which is difference between this point and this point, are also in inverse proportion to interface. So if we increase by 3 order magnitude interface width, also not big deal, just one micrometer, we don't have hysteresis. If you don't have hysteresis, we cannot study nucleation, and we have such stress strain curve, and for such stress strain curve with molecular dynamics and with phase field approach, we have homogeneous transformation. So that is, does not work. That is why we make attempt to develop scale-free approach with some tricks. And key point, we still want to reproduce microstructure, discrete microstructure rather than continuum distribution of concentration of phases. And one of key point is that to have discrete microstructure, we have to have unstable branch at stress strain curve. This is clear. And we started this work quite a while ago, and now we revisited it because proper problem appeared. And we developed theory for large strain, quite sophisticated theory. What I will show now is the simplest version. So completely simplest examples will be with large strain and more complex theory. So key point, this is just a very simple mixture theory. And energy consists of elastic part, thermal energy, and interaction energy. This is typical, and this interaction energy will be responsible for instability and microstructure. This is austenite wind-martensite interface. Of course, if you speak about large scale, we don't want to reproduce all millions of interfaces. So the only order parameter is we want to reproduce only this interface. The only order parameter will be a volume fraction of martensite. And this is a typical expression for interaction energy, which comes from micromechanics. If you consider energy of internal stresses, or if you consider the surface energy, and that is what we will use. At the same time, still we have a volume fraction of each martensitic variant, which don't contribute to interaction energy. They don't introduce any instability, and they are just internal variables, not other parameters. Then, simplest equation again, strain is elastic plus transformational. For transformational strain, we use simple mixture theory, and rate of change of volume fraction for each martensitic variant is sum of rates of transformation between this variant and all other phases. And these are our generalized flux in expression for dissipation rate. And then, using thermodynamics, we derive explicit expression for driving force. This is for austenite to East martensitic variant. It's here, it's transformation Dirk, jump in thermal energy. And this term comes from interaction energy, and it will describe instability. Forget about this term. Similar expression for martensite. Here we have transformation work. Again, forget about this term. And we also introduce a thermal threshold. It's not easy to introduce it in nanoscale phased field approach. There are some methods not very popular. We develop several of them, but still not very often use them. Here it's like in micromechanical theory. We introduce a thermal threshold, and if driving force exceeds the threshold, which is here, we prescribe simple linear kinetic equation between rate of interface change and net driving force. So driving force minus a thermal threshold. Well, now key point, if you want to have a scale-free theory, I am sorry, but we should avoid gradient energy. I understand that this is barely legal, and this is well posed problem, and solution is mesh dependent. Okay, let's see how it's mesh dependent. This story about mesh dependence comes from shear bands, but this is completely different story, because entire instability concentrates not at band but at interfaces, and interfaces are very localized. So again, simple example, simple tension of this sample, different meshes, unstructured, structured, width of interfaces, roughly one finite element. And you see, yeah, and this is light region is interface. Of course, we see that this interface is thinner than this interface, but general topology of solution is the same. And these are very rough mesh even here. Stress strain curves, they're absolutely the same. And we have many examples, and based on them, we came to conclusion. Yes, we can do without gradient term. It changes properties, but it reproduces phenomena. And we solve various problems. So this is cubic to monoclinic phase transformation in nickel titanium crystal, simple tension. And you see blue is martensite. So you see direct phase transition, then reverse phase transition corresponding stress strain curves. And for each state, we have distribution of all 12 variants. So this is complete solution. We show only four major variants, but we have information about all solutions and also stress fields, all stresses they are reproducible here, result of solution. Well, this is different problem, polycrystal, 250 grains. You see very small grains for such sample. And you see nucleation and growth of martensitic bands. So it looks like bands don't fill this grain structure. And actually that is what is observed in previous experiments. Well, now difference not only in geometry here, the same 250 grains. Well, they are not visible, use your imagination. But it's a much lower strain rate. And microstructure teach shown steps is much more relaxed, much more equilibrium. And you see that we reproduce very fine microstructure similar to what we do in traditional nanoscale approach. Well, this is example for 3D. And this is finally a finite strain example. This is cubic to tetragonal phase transition from silicon 1 to silicon 2, uniaxial compression, loop transformation strain, 45% in axial direction, 17% in lateral direction. And this is a solution for first variant, second variant, third variant, and different cuts. And this is under hydrostatic conditions. So again, first variant, second, third variant. And why such funny shape? Because edges don't transform. Edges are in austenitic state. And because of large transformation strain, you see this well-curved structure. So this is all for scale-free approach to phase transformation. Now, our main goal, and we work on this for decades, is to study phase transformations under high pressure. And these are diamond anvils sample. Well, width of sample is from 100 micrometer down to 10, maybe even smaller. So it's, very small size. This diameter is 0.5 millimeters, and this sample compressed by two diamonds. Everyone does this. What we are doing differently after compression, we twist one of anvil with respect to another, superposing large plastic deformation, and this changes everything. There are dozens of very interesting and important phenomena with the trying to understand them, describe them. I will focus only on one of them. Plastic shear significantly reduces phase transformation pressure. Here are examples. Phase transition from hexagonal to superhot versitic boron nitride. Under hydrostatic condition, no phase transition even at 53 GPa. Under large shear, it's 6.7 order of magnitude. Rhombohedral boron nitride to cubic, superhot cubic boron nitride. Again, 55 versus 5.6 for silicon. This is huge phenomenon. At the end, I will show you even stronger result. And good point for us that the classical thermodynamics, even if you will work with stress tensor, strain tensor, does not describe even close this phenomenon. So like, more than 10 years ago, I made hypothesis that this reduction in phase transition pressure can be explained by formation of dislocation pileup during plastic deformation, which produce strong stress concentrator, and that is how new nuclear appears. It was an analytical solution, not bad, it describes many phenomena, but of course it's very primitive. And since then, that is actually was our driving force to develop large strain phase field approach to phase transition, to dislocation, their coupling, and then solve a proper problem. So this is an example for model material under hydrostatic condition, phase equilibrium pressure 10 gigapascal, phase transformation pressure, this is lattice instability pressure for ideal crystal, 20 GPa. If you introduce single dislocation, phase transition occurs at 16 GPa. Now, this is our model by crystal under fixed
stress and prescribed shear. Dislocation you create, so this was a lot of hand waving. Here everything comes from solution. Dislocation you create in left grain, pile up against grain boundary, indeed produce huge concentration of all components of stress tensor, and which exceed in lattice instability threshold, and we get barrierless nucleation. And you see this is result of solution, and pressure average over this grain is 1.2 GPa. So indeed this model explains more than order of magnitude reduction for transformation pressure, and even order of magnitude below phase equilibrium pressure. So this phase transition occurs deeply in the region of stability of low pressure. And we study various cases, but again, problem which we face now, we can treat on the very small samples. How to, okay, we can use now our theory for scale-free theory for phase transformation. We can, of course, combine it with scale-free theory, plasticity theory, right? But point is, we need stress concentrator. We need to keep this location pile up. And what we are doing? We recollect the classical definition of dislocation. So cut, right, and then shift. And keep at the same time traction continuity across cut and normal displacement continuity. And all what I said, this is typical formulation of contact problem in mechanics of continuity. So when we have contact of two bodies, and we allow relative sliding and keep continuity of traction and normal displacement. So now we can use a very well developed code for solving contact problem. We use Abacus for these purposes, and it can be any other code, to model continuum distribution of dislocation. And actually it works well. First, we can easily reproduce stress distribution for single dislocation in such way, of course, excluding singularity. And then you see, we solve the same problem. This is distribution of sliding displacement along this plane. And based on this distribution, we can place dislocations where we need, where they appear. And we change size of system. It's there is no scale. We change size of system by four orders of magnitude. There is no any effect on solution. So indeed, we have now scale independent model for phase transformation and for localized dislocation pileup. And it's not necessarily dislocation pileup. In the same way, we can introduce shear bands, localized shear bands, twinning bands, and even shear cracks. So all of them can be described in such form. Now, again, with solution for the same problem. Let's focus on this right here. What came as surprise, this is very simple, very primitive model. And this is solution. And this is our much more sophisticated nanoscale model. And you see, results are quite close, which is not expected because we did not do anything that make this model valid at nanoscale. But it works, and critical pressure for phase transition is very close for both models. Volume fraction of high pressure phase here, it's slightly lower than here, but you see also close. And the number of dislocation which causes nucleation also the same. So actually such model works from nanoscale and without any limit, and probably for kilometers what we will need for geophysical application. Okay, now let's do a little bit go in detail. This is a solution which we already discussed, but we forbid the plasticity in this grain. If you include plasticity in this grain, you see that the results are, well, volume fraction of high pressure phase is smaller than here, which means that plasticity plays dual role. It produces stress concentrator and promotes phase transition, and it relaxes stress concentrator and suppresses phase transition. And we find such combination of loads where actually promotion wins. Now, what you see the white line. White lines here and here, they correspond to this equality, which I claim that this is phase equilibrium condition at interface. So I derived this equation like in 90s for sharp interface. And its transformation work reaches critical value jump in thermal stresses. And you see that almost at all major interfaces with plasticity, without plasticity, this local equilibrium condition is satisfied. And there is nothing from plasticity. There is no plastic work here. And this is not Eshelby driving force. Yes, plasticity affects indirectly because dislocations contribute to stress field. But in the 90s, we had a discussion. I suggested this equation, and two other groups used added plastic work here. So it's Eshelby driving force. And I gave my arguments. I thought that I won. But now I have much, well, direct confirmation coming from phase field. Okay. Now, next, let's consider such polycrystalline sample and also compression and shear. And this is solution, increasing shear strain. You see evolution of dislocation structure and evolution of martensite, rate is martensite. Again, white lines are most are at all major interfaces. So that means that even for such complex loading, we still have local phase equilibrium condition, which honestly, I'm surprised. But also we follow evolution of each martensitic variance. And one more surprise, even larger surprise, you see this is the same phase equilibrium condition, which we consider for each point of interface. But now what happens, this stress is an average over each grain or average over the entire sample. And still, approximately, we have this phase equilibrium condition. And this part is very important for us because we need to scale up further this result, not within phase field, but to develop kinetic equation for macro scale. And here are details. This is kinetic in each grain, and you see it's very heterogeneous. You see direct and reverse phase transition while we produce monotonous loading. And these are results for entire sample. So how the shear grows volume fraction of total martensite, each martensitic variance, shear stresses, average shear stresses, and pressure. And again, this information plus this information, we need to develop, 3 minutes, okay, to develop a larger scale approach. And very shortly, why we need this? Okay, we want to model behavior of sample in rotational diamond energy. So this is macro scale theory, large strain theory for plasticity and strain-induced phase transition without detail. And I used here kinetic equation, which I derived in 2004, very primitive equation, but actually it was based on what I learned at that time for nucleation at dislocation pileup. It describes an interesting phenomena, so it's not bad, but it's primitive. And now, instead of this kinetic equation, we will want to use this result. But this is model system, it should be calibrated. And good point that, these are result of simulation of behavior of sample, distribution of pressure along radius, distribution of volume fraction of high pressure phase along radius. This is an entire sample. And good point, just a few months ago, we obtained very detailed distribution using in situ synchrotron radiation experiments at argon. This is for alpha to omega phase transition in zirconium. You see here pressure distribution. Okay, this is different loads without shear. Here fixed load with shear. Thickness we can measure also in situ using X-ray absorption. Pressure distribution, not only average pressure distribution in each phase, red, it's a high pressure phase. And what is more important, and this is obtained for the first time, distribution along the sample, along 300 micrometers, distribution of volume fraction of high pressure phase during such load. So now in principle, we can measure this experimentally. We can calculate this for model system. Now we need to marry this and extract the complete information about kinetics, about plastic properties of each phase. We already achieved this without phase transition, just plastic properties in tungsten up to 400 GPa. And very good description of experiments. So this is next stuff. Thank you for your attention.
So in the previous video, you showed the single crystal, nickel titanium, and also you high demand potential.
Right.
So for the 1D case, I saw it's very homogeneous, but the results show there are two bands.
Yes.
So why you have bands, and why it's not homogeneous result?
We need very small perturbations. Very small perturbations, and then band produces. Sometimes this perturbation just come from mesh. So, yeah, go ahead.
You said in the beginning that if the material plastically deforms, the pressure hits the phase transition is 35,
yeah.
And if not, it's 50, correct?
Right.
Could you simply say, why is
that? Okay, I believe that is what I did, that plastic strain generates dislocation pileup with very strong concentration of all components of stress tensor. And locally, roughly speaking, you apply external phi, because of this stress concentrator, you have locally phi. But it's not just... Right, it's manipulating stress, and it's not just 50. It's also shear components, rich yield strengths in shear, not engineering yield strengths. So they are order magnitude higher.
Yeah. Well, okay. I would have some kind of alternative.
Okay.
Sorry for taking time, but in the phase transformation, there's always problem compatibility of strain and interference.
You're talking about check memory. No, but here volumetric strain is 20%, 50%. Yeah, but here there is huge plastic deformation, which provides this compatibility.
Yeah, yeah. It's just saying, looking at the sensing from a different
aspect. Okay. 1 minute. So I would like to use this opportunity to thank symposium organizer, all colleagues and friends who contributed to this symposium, this presentation, and also people who show up. Thank you.
Okay, and our next speaker will be Dr. Levitas from Japan. So he is going to talk about different issues.